Dr. Bimal Jalan needs absolutely no introduction, so I'm not going to waste time doing that. Let me start by asking you, Dr. Jalan, what should the next RBI governor do?
No, I mean, I think I can't say what the government, what the governor should do. I mean, the most important priority at the moment, so far as we are concerned, I mean, that is the country is concerned, as citizens we are concerned, is what can be done in the banking sector to reduce NPAs. Some action has already been taken, and the banks are also doing fast work for restructuring and all that. But at the moment, as it happens, our inflation is within, more or less within control. I mean, there is an anxiety about whether you'd be able to meet the 4 to 6% target and so on and so forth on the CPI. But by and large, I think we are in a comfortable situation. And the banking issues are also being handled. I mean, obviously, there is an issue about investment. I mean, you know, the industrial production rate, as you know, your channel must have been talking about it, is not very high just now. But by and large, I think we have all the resources that we need to augment our investment. Our savings rates are high, and there is no other problem. Our foreign exchange reserves are high, so imports is not a problem if we need it, and so on and so forth. But by and large, I'm optimistic about our future, and the economy is already doing better. I mean, as far as I can understand, both in the corporate sector as well as in the banking sector. So by and large, we're in a comfortable position just now, and hope it continues.
Okay, let me take each of these separately. What would you do if you were asked to take charge again and were told that, all right, you have the experience, you've dealt with very tough times for not only the economy but also for the rupee itself. What would you do to deal with NPAs right now?
No, please forgive me. I should not, you know, I mean, I should not speak on what RBI should do and so on and so forth. The most important thing at the moment is really to increase the capital access, the total capital available to the banks, and which the central bank, the government is already doing to some extent, but much more needs to be done. And then we have to make sure that the credit flow doesn't decline if it is meant not for what you might say working capital, but particularly for investment side, infrastructure, and we must give it the highest priority.
Okay, let me take up the issue of NPAs itself. You know, one part has been that there's been an argument that a lot of these in the past, a lot of loans were getting restructured just so that they would not be declared as NPAs. Once you declare the NPA, you obviously, that goes out of your earnings profile for a bank. But you also have the assets which you can sell. Are banks selling those assets aggressively? Are they taking enough of an aggressive or an, you know, stance vis-a-vis the managements right now? Or would you like to see more?
No, I would naturally. I mean, these things take time to take place. I mean, let us give it about a year or so. Because, I mean, for example, what assets you should sell and what assets you should not sell, which companies are in trouble because of market conditions and which companies are in trouble because they of demand, say consumer demand at the moment is not very high, and so on and so forth. So it has to be based on analysis of the reason for default. I mean, if you have, certain companies, for example, have been cited as having too much leverage, and then naturally, the banks have to take action as soon as possible. But I think everything has to take a little, you know, we should allow for some time to be taken for the reasons why these NPAs have taken place in particular corporate sector and so on and so forth.
Let's take something like power sector.
But the RBI is now taking action, and also...
Go ahead, Dr. Jalan.
Yeah. The power sector, the main issue is about implementation of projects. And that has also been highlighted by the government. I mean, that the implementation of projects in our country, not only this in the public sector, but elsewhere also, is a bit slow. And that is because of the regulatory framework and so on and so forth. The states are involved, center is involved, districts are involved, you know, and lots of agencies are involved in deciding where the road would be built, what would be done, and so on and so forth. But what I am saying essentially is that the main issue in our country is how to implement project on time, and the government has also talked about it. And let us see what we can do to achieve that particular objective.
I just wanted to specifically talk about the power sector, because you were saying that one has to look at whether there is it's a demand constraint driven issue, or it's just a market condition, temporary market condition driven issue. You know, one of the things that emerged through the excessive kind of, I wouldn't say excessive, but a huge amount of exposure to power sector for many of these banks, including PSU banks, was that the price at which demand existed, or the effective demand for power, didn't exist at the price at which these projects can actually break even. So has that changed? Will that change at all?
No, I think there are two, you know, these are very difficult issues, because there is always a trade-off. Mm. Because we want to make electricity available in rural areas among low-income groups and so on and so forth, about which Prime Minister has also spoken. And then, of course, the power, if the supposing the manufacturing cost of power or delivery of power is costing money, then either the subsidies for the power sector has to increase. But to supply, to be able to make power available in distant areas, rural areas, and so on, at affordable prices for households. So there are always those issues which have to be grappled, and I am in favor of anything that can be done to make the outreach of electricity availability and the benefit of electricity in rural households to the extent possible. And if necessary, that has to be given a very high priority.
You know, most of it is in the domain of state governments.
For the urban sector, for the well-off sectors.
I'm saying most of these are in the domain of state governments. State electricity boards have to buy the power. Someone has to finance that state electricity board. Many of them are bankrupt. State governments say, we don't have the money. Does the center need to do a bit of subsidizing there?
Yes, of course. I mean, you know, I mean, in terms of all these issues, I mean, there are two sides to the coin. It costs, I mean, fiscal deficit also has to be restrained. Yes, central public sector deficit and fiscal deficit has to be restrained. Similarly, states may not have enough funds. They may be doing subsidies much more than that. So a lot of, I mean, this is a part of a much larger problem of what is it that we are achieving through many of the very large expenses on many of the other subsidies. Power is an essential item, important public good. Roads are important public goods, and we have to make sure that these have the higher priority than other things which can be done by merging subsidies and so on, which also the government has started. So let's wait and see.
This government has been quite proactive in prioritizing subsidies compared to many other governments. This one has been very proactive there. Also benefited quite a bit for the fact that the entire oil subsidy has more or less disappeared. So that has been of great use. You know, the fiscal deficit question, you talk to corporates, especially those who are in the infrastructure sector or those who are in capital goods sector, they all feel that the government should spend a little more, and if required, maybe just give that FRBM target a little bit of a miss for a few years. Would you be in that camp, or would you say no?
That's a very important issue, because the FRBM target, which was set in the previous FRBM bill, was specific. So once it has been legislatively decided that I must have a fiscal deficit, or the fiscal deficit should be confined to, say, 3.5% or whatever the number is, then obviously the government doesn't have very much of a freedom to exceed that target, and it must be met. But the more important point is, from a large, longer term perspective, is that a specific target should not be legislatively prescribed. I mean, for example, today we are in a comfortable situation of having a very great, very good monsoon. But supposing you didn't have a very good monsoon, and you were in a situation where there was drought or something, and much more money had to be spent in that direction, so then we should be able to meet it through a higher deficit of 0.2% or 3%. It doesn't matter all that much, as long as inflation is within control. I mean, that is the more important issue. as long as money supply is within reasonable bound and available for investment. So these are all different aspects of the issues which have to be balanced, and the which you give priority to may differ from time to time.
So
sorry to be so vague, but I mean that is what I'm trying to say.
That's absolutely. Yes. That's actually.
At the moment, we are in a very comfortable situation. Inflation. Yeah.
No, I'm saying that in a, just as the government this time was against putting that GST cap in the constitution itself, in the act itself, and finally there was a give and take, and that did not get put in. Similarly, this FRBM target. Shouldn't there have been a range? Should the government go to parliament again and try and get an amendment through that we should be allowed to spend a little bit more?
No, but they are now working on the new FRBM. You see, the most important issue also you should keep in mind is that if the FRBM target is achievable, for example, like we did in the last budget. So then there is no point in making a legislative amendment to that point.
If there is no particular we achieved that by not spending involved. We achieved that by not spending, and if the government had done a little bit more capital expenditure.
No, by not spending on what?
As I said, that if they'd done a little bit more capital expenditure, maybe spent a little bit in the agriculture sector, then we would have been able to probably seen a better growth than we've seen right now. In some senses, their hands were tied.
No, no, but everybody may have a different hypothesis, you know. I mean, the hypothesis may be that, yes, because of the fiscal deficit target, we couldn't do this, that, or the other. But the other hypothesis or the other reality may also be contrary to that. That the amount of expenditure that we do in some of the areas that you mentioned, it is not a very large part of the fiscal deficit. So what I'm trying to get to you is that the most important point is that we should not have a specific legislative target for fiscal deficit, in my view. And I hope in the next FRBM Act, I mean the previous FRBM Act, whatever it prescribed, etc., etc., is still valid, but the fiscal deficit target has been met. And for the next FRBM Act, which is also being at the moment considered, I hope that we should, you know, use the word reasonable, or we should within bounds, subject to inflation being under control and so on and so forth. But that flexibility must be left to the government to decide from year to year, depending on the circumstances of our country.
Dr. Jalan, you spoke about the, you know, slightly tepid numbers that we've seen on IIP. We are very happy with even a 2.1%, year-on-year growth. And we say that this is better at least than last month or the previous month, and that gives hope for growth. But how do you get out of this cycle of slow industrial growth? Because the services sector has boomed, that's all fine. But how do you get out of it?
No, you don't have to get out of it. I mean, what I'm saying is that industrial production, manufacturing production, and so on and so forth will depend on demand. And therefore, let's wait for the consumer demand to expand. Let us wait for better growth rate in the and also for higher employment. And let us see whether we can increase the total industrial production for example, if you were to doing investment, accelerate investment, highway building, and so on and so forth, then industrial production will increase. I mean, you would need cement, you would need, you know, whatever, various kinds of other manufactured items, and that would help.
So you're saying that demand, consumption, so demand will
grow?
What
I'm trying to get to you is yes, consumption demand would grow if you have very good monsoon, for example, this year.
But historically,
so
you would...
Consumer demand grows, and there, for example...
Sorry, there's a bit of a delay because of which I think we're...
hello? Yeah. Sorry.
But let me just finish the question. What I was saying, that historically has, you know, good monsoon generated enough demand? Because good monsoon would generally generate demand from, let's say, the rural sector, right? And the rural sector itself is highly differentiated. Right after two droughts, we will see a period when just the indebtedness of farmers will first have to get what one would have to call their balance sheet back in order before they can start consuming. Now, would you require at least 2 months, good monsoons, for us to see that consumption revival? In your experience, how have you seen that in the past?
No, you see, in relative terms, I mean, what one is saying is that consumption, total consumption demand this year will be higher than the previous year when we didn't have such a good monsoon. I mean, of that, there is very little doubt. But whether it is 10%, 15%, or 12%, all these particular increases, etc., the percentage quantitative increases, would depend on what you have said. How much debt I have, which has the priority, and so on and so forth. But this is part of a larger equation, as it were. What I'm saying is a good monsoon is very positive, and we should encourage the investment side of whatever the government has announced to be implemented on time, which is also one of the objectives. And if we do all that, investment acceleration, completion of projects on time, you mentioned power projects and so on and so forth, and availability of electricity in rural areas as well as semi-urban areas, I mean, all this would help. So this is what I am trying to get to you, is that this is a combination of various things, and choices have to be made at times, whether I should do this or that. At the moment, we are in a very comfortable situation to make the choice of accelerating investment, completing projects, making available the best that we can in terms of subsidies for food, nutrition, health, and so on and so forth. So let's get on with the delivery system. Mm-hmm. Let's get on with reducing the cost of administration. Let's get on with the effectiveness of what we are doing on the ground in terms of investment. Those are the more important part than these figures that we are talking about.
All right, let me move the question a little bit to the global scenario. You've been someone who's actually seen it over years. You know, just yesterday I read that for the first time, perhaps a German bank is actually going to ask people to pay money for keeping their money in the bank account. So the interest rate is going to be negative. Have you ever seen that before? A situation where there's deflation, negative interest rates globally. Have you seen that before?
No, I mean, globally, I have not seen that. I mean, before, in the sense that I don't remember. But the rate of interest globally is much lower than ours over a period of time. And say, for example, the target in the US or something like that would be, say, roughly in the region of 1 or 2%. Negative interest rates are nowhere favored, as far as I can see, because that is not something which is sustainable. But different countries have a different scenario in terms of inflation. We are dominated, for example, by food, by agriculture, and so on. And so our revenue, our inflation targets, etc., would be higher than what would be the case globally. At the moment, the global issues in Europe, for example, in Britain with Brexit, in the US also, I mean, there are several downturns. Japan, things are improving, but there is an issue. China, it's not growing as fast as it was. So there are global issues of this type. But fortunately for us, we are not that dependent on trade. So we can, if we accelerate our own investment, we can do it without having to have a very large trade surplus, as it were.
All right, Dr. Jalan, you've given us a lot of your time. Thank you so much for speaking to us.
Okay.
Profit. Thanks a lot.
No, thank you. A pleasure talking to you.